हरे कृष्णा सनत कुमार रो, वेलकम टू द मॉन्क्स पॉडकास्ट।
हरे कृष्णा,
थैंक
थैंक यू
यू।
सो मच फॉर इनवाइटिंग मी टू स्पीक।
यस
यस,
ब्रो, सिंस द टाइम आई मेट यू सेवरल इयर्स अगो एंड आई हर्ड अबाउट ऑल दैट यू आर डूइंग हियर एंड देन आफ्टरवर्ड व्हेन आई ट्रैवल अब्रॉड एंड डिवोटीज आस्क अबाउट व्हाट ऑल इज हैपनिंग स्पेशली विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द गोवर्धन इको विलेज। इवन इफ डिवोटीज फ्रॉम ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड कम हियर, they primarily visit the eco village and see what the eco village, but not many know about the various activities that are happening with respect to rural development and rural outreach. And the awards that have been won themselves are quite impressive. So I'll share with mentioning some of the awards, and then maybe you can tell us about how all this started and where it is going now. Is that okay?
Yes.
So probably the most celebrated award that we won was the United Nations Award, and from that's something which is United Nations World Tourism Organization Award for ecotourism as a catalyst for rural development. That is in 2017 Madrid, and that I think in the whole ISKCON world itself, and it created a sensation. And also in, I was told, even the Maharashtra government, they were stunned, you know, which is this, what is this place, we don't know about, but it is being attracting international attention.
Yes.
And apart from that, there are several other awards. Actually, I have another document which has a dozen awards, which I'll probably put in the information sheet in the podcast. But Indian Institutes of Architects Award for Excellence for Eco Village Design, an International Green Apple Award for Best Environmental Practices, 2015 London. Then Limca Book of Records for Organic Farming Techniques, winner of Scotch Platinum Award for Water Conservation 2013 Delhi, the winner of Asian Spirituality Leadership Award for Best Overall Sustainable Performance, that is Dubai. And I also came to know that recently we have been awarded the Krushi Bhushan Award, which is the highest award in the state of Maharashtra in the field of agriculture. So this is quite a unparalleled level of accomplishment, and not just accomplishment, but recognition of the accomplishment by the world. So can you share some background of how all this came about and what exactly are these awards given for?
Yes, you see, as all these awards that we got, it is what Vaishnava Prabhupada started. You see, Prabhupada founded ISKCON Society in 1965. And in 1967, he established Nirundavan, that is farm community. So right from the beginning, the farm communities were in his mind, right? So whatever Srila Prabhupada has said, we are just like trying to fulfill that award. And we can see how Srila Prabhupada was so much visionary that by simply implementing few of the things which he said, we could attract the attention of all these people. Because 50 years back, when there was not much talk about sustainability or ecology or environment, the science and all those things, that's the time Srila Prabhupada was thinking about this. Because Prabhupada knew very well the current society who is trying to just fulfill their material needs without caring for the nature, ultimately will have a disastrous effect. And then now it's like everywhere in international scene, we see people talk about ecology, environment sustainability, and then non-toxic food and all those things, which Prabhupada could envisage almost 50 years back. So this is what I felt, and under the leadership of His Holiness Radhanath Swami Maharaj, all the group of devotees here in Govind village is
Just one minute,
working
bro, about this
towards
point which
that.
you mentioned. Sorry, just one minute about this point of Prabhupada being like a
Yes.
environmental visionary. sometimes we focus a lot on Prabhupada's spiritual teachings, and this aspect of his farsightedness is overlooked. So what you said is, I was reading recently a book about Indian spiritual leaders who went and pioneered, say, Indian spirituality in the West. So they said that most of the spiritual leaders talked about, say, inner development, feel good, but hardly anyone else apart from Prabhupada talked about environmental matters so presciently. So in a sense, we have focused a lot on the temple outreach and devotional festivals. And of course, Prabhupada is the pioneer for Kirtan, but Prabhupada is a pioneer for sustainability and eco-friendly living. That is something which, while we have done, we have made efforts for having farm communities, but that aspect of Srila Prabhupada, I feel sometimes it has not been adequately highlighted, how visionary he was, what you said. So I just wanted to second what you said, and I said that there are some eminent books on Indian spirituality in the West, are also recognizing it. Thank you.
Because Srila Prabhupada knew, we are talking about giving more importance to the spirit soul and less importance to the bodily necessity, working morely on the soul platform, and then whatever is necessary for the bodily maintenance, we have to do it. So then people will ask, how do I live according to this? So if you see what was the Vedic system, the Vedic system was every family, mostly it was village-based, and all the villages were self-sufficient in themselves. So all the requirements of the village were fulfilled within the village itself. And that's how, whatever happened in the world, the village economy was not disturbed. But then today, what has happened in this global economy scenario, that if the oil prices go up, a small person in the village also gets affected because his prices shoot up. So no matter what happened in the world, what kind of wars happened, still the villagers could carry on their culture, carry on their spiritual pursuits, and carry cooperation with the nature. What Prabhupada knew it very well, that people are working for the things which they don't need. So let's say there is one circle we put, and that we call as a needs.
Okay?
Then you put a next circle around, you call it as a comforts. Then you put another circle around it, you call it as luxuries. Then you put another circle around it, you call that as the prestige. And then you add one more circle around it, it's called greed. As needs and comforts are there, you can easily stay in cooperation with the nature without unnecessary working hard for that. To a certain extent, luxury may be possible. But then what does mean by prestige? Next thing is suppose you need one car. Car is needed for transportation. But then people will have very costly cars for themselves. They may have one BMW, then another Mercedes and another things. That means you just leave for the prestige, and neighbor has got as many cars, so I should have additional ones. And then that means that point onwards, you start exploiting the mother nature, and then you will have less time for the spiritual activities. And those who go for greed is actually the root cause of all the diseases, which Srila Prabhupada knew it very well, that what is this society that is based on the consumeristic model. Even we have seen in Bhagavatam also, in Bali Maharaj's episode, that it was very clear. Vamandir said heart is not satisfied, no matter even if you offer him all the gold, all the silver, all the jewels in the world, and still he will not be satisfied. That's why you find Mahatma Gandhi also said there is enough for everybody's need, for not one man's greed. So this is what happens is like, you know, people, and they start living for the greed in the life, then they start exploiting the mother nature. So this is what happened. Now we discuss something about like how the civilization is going away from the main focus, which should be doing it. So we will explain about like, you know, how the progress is maintained, how the progress is measured in today's world. The progress is measured in today's world in the form of GDP. Right?
Okay, just a bag. I mean, I understand. So are you giving this as a background for this project, or I mean, or are you explaining the rationale for Prabhupada's vision, or both?
Now, the thing is, it's a both that is needed to understand.
Yes, please.
Because if you want to live on the land, first you need to be convinced. And you need to be deeply rooted in Srila Prabhupada's understanding of the farm projects. Otherwise, little bit difficulties here and there, and then you may lose the focus. So what we have to understand is this, the way today's world is measuring the success, it is such a defective way of measuring the success. Now see, the God has given us nice grapes. And you eat those grapes and you will be very healthy. But when there is a greed in the heart, what you do is you make wine from that, right? And then the more wine factories are there in the world or in that one particular nation, the GDP of that nation will increase. What happens is, if the people consume more wine, then a lot of social problems that they happen. So because of the greed is there in the human heart, is not satisfied with what God has provided, but will try to earn more and more things, thinking that the money will give me, the wealth will give me happiness. So he will convert the good grapes into
wine.
Wine.
So is it
that wine industry?
Yeah.
And so wine as the becomes, people consume.
So is wine like a greater parameter in the GDP as compared to grapes? Because you're talking about...
What I'm saying is, so suppose if a nation is living very simple, then they don't need these things. But if they go in for more gross domestic products, then they will add these industries. So what people will think, they have got more industries, the GDP is more, so that is considered as the developed nation. And those whose is less, that is considered as underdeveloped nations. But this measurement of success itself is defective, because let's say if there is an accident, the GDP will go up. Why? Because the medical insurance company, the hospital bills, all those things goes up. And then artificially you see that there is a growth in GDP. But actually that's not the way the success is measured. So what happening is people are going after this illusory definition of success. And because of this, Prabhupada knew very well that if they do this, then they will be exploiting the resources, natural resources.
Okay.
Because earth will provide for needs, it will provide for your comforts. But if people start exploiting the mother nature, then the earthly resources are not sufficient. So that's why it is said, like, if people live by the standard of living of US America, then you will need at least 5 earth planets, then all people in the world can standard.
I've heard about that. Yes, that
so you understand.
True.
So that's why Prabhupada wanted, like,
now going back to the GDP point estimate. So it's very striking. So it's like a moral measure. It is just going to measure how much industries are there, but whether those industries are producing something good or whether they're actually necessary, that doesn't come into the, because it's just a mathematical measure. So we need other parameters for a more holistic evaluation. So some industries may be actually necessary. They may do something good also, but the GDP will not have a calibration for that. So I remember in Japan, I read something, there was a big conflict because a lot of people were dying because of smoking. And then the health industry was saying we should put some restriction on smoking. But from the government's point of view, the tobacco industry was providing income and the health industry was taking out income or taking money. So in a sense, they were getting money, so they were not ready to put curbs on this. So yeah, it's a very striking point that so the GDP has no ethical element to it at all, or even not even ethical element, just the element of what is actually being produced that is not measured at all. It is just whether it is being produced or not. Very striking. Thank you for sharing that.
So usually what happens is people just go on consuming. The more nation consumes, it's considered as a rich person. But you don't have that much sufficient natural resources.
Hmm.
And then people are becoming happy by consuming the resources. So suppose if any country has got a lot of, say, gambling units, that casinos and all those kind of stuffs, which like many developing countries are trying to establish in their countries. But you all know the people who these are the addictions, like the alcohol is addiction, and this gambling is addictions. And then citizens, are they happy with these things? They're not happy. And then a lot of other social evils also take place. So this is what exactly that today's society is measuring success in the wrong parameters. And we should have a proper parameters to measure the success. So This is what like I will explain these things is like it's agriculture, we say, right?
Mm-hmm.
So food is a culture. But you will see most of the today's world, they are using the word agribusiness.
Yes, agribusiness.
So like in many of the places in the world, the Mother Earth is considered as mother.
Hmm.
Earth is considered as mother. In Vedic tradition, very much clear that it's a mother. And mother will definitely provide for the children's upkeep, for the necessities. But if the children are using some destructive lifestyle, then it will withheld. So let's take likeness. So Prabhupada was saying if you have a farm communities, actually you will have a security. So this I will explain, replaced by the business. So if you see Indian society about say 60 years back, 60, 70 years back, mostly the villages, they produce the things the family needs.
Mm.
And whatever the needs of the village are there. And I'm very clear. In 1971 and 72, there was a very heavy drought in India. I still remember, I was a child in the newspaper, all those pictures were there where the land is happy. What happened was cash crop. All the central part of Maharashtra, there was a cotton. This was there in coastal region in humid climate. So then what happened is this is how the cash crop started coming into picture. So cash crop is like the cotton is giving good price. So let's cultivate more and let us get more and more income. And that's how the people started putting all sorts of, then they started getting hybrid seeds, they started getting GM seeds. Now cotton in Maharashtra is genetically, the prosperity was measured in terms of the grains and the cows. So as people started getting into cash, then they started exploiting the mother nature. And then what happened is previously all your needs were satisfied in the villages, because like before we got this place, we were in down, and near our farm was the river. So whenever we had to cross the river, we had to use boatman service. So we never used to pay like daily to him. At the harvesting season, we would just give him one bag of jowari, the millets. And that's how like na, we used to pay to the different, like na, the blacksmith, you pay him one grain of this thing. So all the trades that were required for supporting the agriculture, they did not ask for the cash. They asked for the grains. So you hardly need any cash for that.
And this was just 20, 30, 25 so, years ago, isn't it? This is
25 years ago, and in some villages, some remote villages, still the system is there. You don't need cash much. You just need the like grains to pay. Now we'll share you one of the very striking example that I got during this Corona period.
Yes, please.
You see what happened as the Corona started. See, initially few months was little scary, like na. We never imagined like na Bombay, the railways will be stopped, then the you're not allowed to go out anywhere. People would go out, the police would beat them. And all the reports were coming like, na, so many people are affecting the corona all over the world. The corona is spreading. So one time, the whole world was locked down. Na? You can't move. So then we calculated like, na, how many devotees are staying on the Govardhanika village. So we said like, na, there are 300 devotees. So now I thought like 300 devotees are there. Now I don't know how long this lockdown will continue. Maybe it will continue like this for a year. So then I called my agriculture department. I called our rural development department. And I told them like how much food grains we have. So then they calculated and then they said, no, we have enough of food grains for 1.5 years, even if this lockdown continues, for all our 300 inmates.
Our so agriculture department means here the GEV itself.
GEV agriculture. GEV itself.
That means what we have produced here or what we have already stocked over here or both?
Produced also. And then some of the things we purchased it from our neighboring farmers, rural development, who are teaching the organic farming techniques.
Okay.
So together. So then I said 1.5 years. Food grain stock we have. And plus like in 1.5 years, there will be at least 4 seasons in which we can grow the food. So that means even if like, food we consume, we will keep growing it also. So we don't care what happens in the world. So we went on like, we should start rationing the things. But then I said, there is no need to ration at all because 1.5 years stock is there. And plus like, na, this rainy season will come and again the new fresh stock of rice we can grow. So then we celebrate all our festivals as usual without any tension. So
amazing.
The there in the food stocks, food grains, and cows who will give you the milk. Now those people who are staying in the cities, now those who lost the job, so they did not get the money. They don't have money from where they will buy food grains. So they were so much in anxiety, those who were dependent on the cash economy. Lockdown, they lost the job or they lost these things. So that's the time I could see that how Prabhupada has given us such a beautiful project. And you could really experience the security. And then you could easily go on with your spiritual practices. So this is what like I felt the genius of Prabhupada.
Amazing. So in a way, because of what you said about self-sufficiency, you in some ways experienced that self-sufficiency had been achieved even without any like consciously striving for that. It's in a sense, you said you discovered it, that you had not thought in that direction, but you found it when you checked that when the situation comes up. So the self-sufficient that was in the past, it was like a byproduct of living in this way, isn't it?
Yes, because what Prabhupada is trying to say by this farm projects is the real security will be with the food grains and the cows from the cow's milk. If you have that, you can live peacefully in this world.
Right.
Now what you are doing is like, you are trying to work in different professions and all that, and you are depending on the currencies, and you are thinking that if I have a lot of money, I will be happy. But then what you have to understand is you need money for what? Say if you want to buy a phone or TV or laptops or different cars, for these things you need money. In the time says, without all those things, you still you can live. Without food grains, you can't live. Your security should be in the food grains. And now you see what happens is the whole society, you will see like they want to give inheritance to their children. And what inheritance they want to give is a bank balance, cash and all those things. But actually the real inheritance, if they want to give to the future, they should be giving them the in food grains, the clean soil, clean water and clean air. Because now what we have seen, because of the greed, we have polluted our food, we have polluted our air, we have polluted all our water supplies. So a real inheritance, if you want to give it, is in the form of the food grains and land and the cows.
Yeah.
Because what Prabhupada could see, because of the greed, people are exploiting the mother nature. And actually, the today's generation has consumed the future generation's natural resources. At least we were fortunate that our ancestors gave us a very clean earth, very clean water, and very clean air to breathe. Are we handing over these things to our future generation? That's why Prabhupada wanted focus should be more on these things.
Yes, Prabhu. Actually, this is a very... I'm realizing that this is almost like we are having two distinct subjects. One is the necessity for eco-friendly living. And then we talk about the way it has been implemented over here. And maybe we'll need two separate podcasts for this. Because this itself, what you're talking about, I'm sure you can also, you have done seminars on this and you can elaborate on this. And I would also like to discuss about it. So do you want to go further in this direction, or you would like to focus on we could do this podcast entirely about eco-friendly living, and in the future session, we can have another about rural development if you like, or you want to combine it now?
It's a go hand in hand.
Okay.
I think separated.
Okay. So if I understand how this is connected is, what you're saying is three ways. First is that like how Prabhupada's vision is something which we can see vindicated or confirmed even in today's crisis situation. And that was the last point you made, and the latest point you made. Before that, you also said that we discussed about what success we have achieved over here. That may be measured in one way from the awards that people have got. But another way we can measure it is that just that we were self-sufficient over here. So that's also another way of looking at the success. And overall, then, how we are successful and how the current situation is unsustainable. For that, you give some background about, I like that hierarchy of need, comforts, luxuries, then prestige, and then greed. So needs and comforts can come through nature without much effort. But then when it becomes excessive, then it becomes a problem. Yes, bro. This is a solid grounding you have given us. So were you always interested in say environmental consciousness, or was this something which just sparked off after reading Prabhupada's books? Or because, like you mentioned, even before this Govardhan Eco Village project, the Dawn project, you were one of the pioneers. So how did you get involved in this whole field?
Actually, because of my law background, Maharaj wanted me to look for the land. And actually, Maharaj wanted this land when I joined in 1988-89. I remember, like, you know, we used to go and see a few pieces of land, but we are not satisfied with that. And then later on, I got the services of taking care of, in Chowpatty, we had orphanage. And I was given the responsibility of handling the children's.
Hmm.
And then as I was taking care of the children's, I saw, like, you know, I thought, let me visit to their homes. And many of the children were coming from village background, because I was born and brought up in Bombay. So I did not know anything about farming. I could not even understand how the rice plant looks like and how the wheat plant looked like. So I then during the vacation time, I started visiting the children's homes, visiting some of the parents and villages. And that's how first I came in contact with the villages. And then some other got attracted to this village lifestyle. And at the same time, as you reach the Prabhupada books, you can clearly see, like, Prabhupada wanted farm communities very much. And then he was always talked about that how this industrial growth or the current way of living will not actually give the satisfaction. So then we located the land in town. After looking at the land,
late 90s?
99.
Okay, I think this was the time when the Y2K was also a matter of concern, no?
Yes, definitely.
Yeah.
So that's one of the reasons that prompted us to go for this project. And then we started living there on the land. Then I started understanding how we should do the agriculture. And how I understood is the first person, then I started, like, let me go and see who are doing agriculture in an organic way or in a natural way. So the first, so I started visiting the different farmers' fields and started understanding how they are doing things. So the very first farmer I went is a very famous, internationally famous natural farmer, very close to our farm here in Wada, about 100 kilometers north of our land. And the first thing he taught me is the weeds actually give the wealth. Because what happens is, like, nowadays you will see in conventional agriculture, weeds are considered as a nuisance. And that is why all the weedicides and herbicides have come. And these are, like, you know, polluting all over the land, water, and air, and is one of the major cause of different kinds of diseases in the world.
Oh.
So what modern science and what modern way of thinking, conventional way of thinking, was thinking that the weeds are actually harmful. Whereas this person was saying, actually, it is the wealth. So how I saw, like, say it's a weed that grows, you cut it and give as a fodder to the cows. At the same time, like, different kinds of weeds are good greens. Like, you can make a very good vegetables, which are medicinal in varieties. Medicinal varieties of green vegetables are available in that. So it's a very good food for the human being, very good food for the cows. At the same time, it will give a ground cover. Now you see, you are sitting in the room, right?
Hmm.
And then if you just go out and stand in the sun, how long you can stand in the sun?
It's too hot. We can't for very long.
For 5 minutes at the most, you will stand in and immediately you will come in the shade. And you are such a, like, you know, we are grown up human beings. And in the land, there are so much, like, the microorganisms are working. They need some shelter to work under. So this, that's how the nature has made this green cover in the form of a weed, which can easily grow and cover the mother earth. And so many microorganisms grow in that.
Oh, okay.
The natural system, the conventional farming, say like, na, you destroy it.
Oh, so by conventional, you're not referring to traditional. Conventional means what is considered the convention right now in the world.
Yes,
what right the mainstream, now. We could say, okay, mainstream, okay.
Mainstream agriculture.
Okay, so is this true for all weeds? Because I've also read about, say, how sometimes some pests come and attack and they destroy the whole farms. So is it that we can't really, means many things which you may consider undesirable, they're not as undesirable. But it's not that all of nature is benevolent. There are aspects of nature which are also dangerous, and we need to counter them. Isn't it?
This is what exactly what I am trying to say.
Okay.
That nature is a perfect in itself. What is the shloka of
Purnamada Purnamidam?
So if this world has come from the complete perfect, it is going to be, and problem is human interference. Because of the excess greed, we make human interference, and that's why the problem happens. Now you take the example of forest. For thousands of years, the forests are maintained. If the pest comes, if there is no natural arrangement to counteract that, then forest would have been destroyed long back. Isn't it as a simple common sense? That means nature has made perfect arrangement to take care of it itself. And that's why we find that the forest and all this ecosystem is surviving for thousands of years.
Can I play the devil's advocate here?
And why, let's see, let me complete this.
Yeah, please, yeah.
And what is the problem is that because of the greed, we try to take more. So once you spray chemical these things, all the good pest and the bad pest both gets destroyed.
Okay.
And ecosystem gets lost. Because always like that, there are like some insects that will eat the plants. There are some insects which are non-vegetarians, they will eat that pest. So nature has created perfect balance for that. But when you spray the chemicals, the natural balance is affected. I will give you one example. You know that Chernobyl in Russia, there was
That is radioactive nuclear waste, basically.
So you remember that? Because I was in school that time.
Yeah, it was a huge disaster.
It's a huge disaster. So that means nuclear radiation means all, everything got devastated. Nothing remained there. So what Russian government is, they cordon off that area. Because nobody was allowed to go, because somebody goes there nearby in that particular area, radiation will affect. So what happened after 25 years? Some research people wanted to go and see. They saw whole nature has come back. All different kinds of vegetation is there. All the animal species are there. How did that happen? It happened because of only one thing. What was that? There was no human intervention in that. So that shows how the nature is powerful, how Krishna's creation is powerful, and it has got full potency to regenerate itself.
Sorry, what was the last time you said that? Because human involvement is not there, so are you saying Chernobyl recovered back, or what was the point you're making?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Okay.
The whole vegetation came back. The different trees grew there. Different kinds of plants came up. Different kinds of animals also came up.
Okay.
Where, from where did it come? Because neutral holocaust, everything got neutralized. No, all seeds, everything was destroyed.
So nature has the capacity nature has the capacity to regenerate itself. That's what you're saying.
Regenerate itself. Yes.
Yeah. That's true. See, there is no denying the fact that many of human actions have severely damaged the ecology. At the same time, you know, not all human actions are necessarily, not human, all human interventions in nature are simply driven by greed. So that means, so for example, if I take a devil's advocate, even agriculture, strictly speaking, is not a natural activity. Agriculture doesn't happen in nature. Agriculture has to be done by conscientious human effort. So we could say even agriculture itself is a technology. Now, the way crops we harvest and irrigate and grow them, it doesn't happen automatically in nature. So agriculture is not like, say, fruits or, like you said, weeds and fruits and other and shrubs that grow naturally. So we could say agriculture is also a result of human intervention in nature. But it is a human intervention which is not disruptive. And we can say even in that degree, so agriculture is not disruptive, but agribusiness becomes disruptive. So, you know, I'm just a little uncomfortable with the idea saying that nature is perfect in the sense that ultimately material nature is filled with old age, disease and death. So there are so many diseases that can come from nature. So when we say it's perfect, even the Pandavas, they burned the Khandava forest to build a city over there. So there are some limitations beyond which when human actions go, then they become destructive. But to some extent, as humans, we need to intervene in the actions of nature, but do it in a non-disruptive way. Because if we just leave it to nature, we humans don't have any defenses. If we're just living in forests, the predators in the jungle could very easily rip us apart and eat us. So when we have some weapons, we don't have natural weapons for self-defense. So even a sword or a knife, that is at one level a primitive technology. So I'm a little uncomfortable with the idea of nature being all perfect and any intervention of human beings in the natural order being bad. Sometimes the human intervention in natural order is essential for our survival. And sometimes the human intervention is such that it makes nature's survival difficult and then our survival also becomes impossible. So maybe we need a stratification in this. Something like natural intervention in goodness, natural intervention in passion, natural intervention or human intervention in goodness, passion, ignorance.
The thing is, what happens is like those who have studied the village life, they can easily understand these things. First, let us see how we should live in this world. We should be living in harmony according to the way Krishna wants us to live in this world.
Okay.
We have to live.
Makes sense.
Living in respect for Mother Earth. So who is Mother Earth? Is Bhumi Devi. She is a consort of Lord Varahadev.
Okay.
And so she is like Lakshmi herself. So we have to honor her and live it in such a way so that we replenish her resources rather than exploit her resources. And whatever resources she has given it to us,
okay,
to use it in the service of Lord Vishnu. So that's the way people should be living it.
Okay.
So, and then the thing is, agriculture was always existing. It's not like those people who give this theory man has come from monkey and then they stayed in forest and then they started doing agriculture. But if you see, Janak Maharaj, he was stealing the land and that's how he found Mother Sita, right?
Yes.
Literature, the agriculture was always existing.
Yeah, I think you made a very significant difference. I got your point that, it is not that we simply want to live according to nature or living naturally doesn't mean just letting nature live its way. Living naturally means living the way Krishna wants us to live, the way Krishna has taught us to live. So if you could say living naturally, we could give up all aspects of culture. There are so many things which human beings do, which animals don't do. We cook our food, we wear clothes, we interact in cultured ways. So when we are talking about, there's a difference between living in harmony with nature and simply letting nature have its way entirely. So agriculture, so you made the another point also is that we exploiting the resources or replenishing the resources.
Yes.
So with agriculture, we are not actually exploiting because agriculture has its own cyclic way by which the resources get replenished. Whereas other forms of business, like say those which are based on fossil fuel and other professions, they are using non-replenishable resources. So that means I like the difference between say like living naturally versus living in harmony with nature and living in harmony with nature according to what Krishna has taught us.
Yes.
That is our purpose. Yeah.
And then just few points that you mentioned about the animals, they will rip us apart. Usually what happens is because I stayed in the villages and near forest, usually the forest animals will never come to the villages. What has happened is the man has destroyed the forest and our forest department has planted the kind of commercial trees like eucalypt and all those things in the forest. So then what happens is all the monkeys, elephants, they don't have anything to eat in the forest. So then they come to the village and just destroy the farmers' crops. Otherwise, if you just maintain the forest the way it is, the animals will be happy to remain in the forest and eat nicely. But man has destroyed all the forest and made the monoculture, because monoculture is never there in the nature. Nature is always biodiversity. And all this conventional agriculture is going us into the direction of the monoculture, and which is going to be very harmful for the nature and harmful for the human beings.
By monoculture, you basically mean that we just try to make everything homogeneous, that whatever is the most financially lucrative.
Monoculture means is usually you will see huge only wheat and corn.
Oh, okay.
All these are grown in a mass scale basis.
Okay.
Because if you see Vedic, this thing, it was like a biodiversity. And the more kind of different kinds of millets, different varieties of rice, different varieties of dals are there, more varieties of vegetables are there, you remain healthy because you get overall nutritions. But today the food habits have changed. It's morely like wheat-based, corn-based, nuts, because that is very easy for them to cultivate through the big tractors and mechanized agriculture. Oh. Whereas agriculture, the way it's being done all these years, apart from green revolution center, before that, it was a biodiversity. And the Lord had created companion crops, one crop will help another crop. And that actually gives the prosperity. It's good for health. So now mechanized agriculture is actually destroying the biodiversity. That was what was a natural the God has given it to us.
That's significant. That means not only are we having industries which are not sustainable, but even agriculture is not sustainable. The way agriculture is done. Oh, that's quite sobering. Yeah.
I would like to explain one thing about this agriculture. How many times Prabhupada explained in his books that you can live off the land. See, 1 acre of land and a cow and all the necessities of yourself will be satisfied by the land.
Hmm.
Have you read about these things?
Yes, several times, yes.
Anybody who is a Prabhupada followers or anybody who is reading Prabhupada books, many times he will come across these things.
Yeah.
But what is the scenario that is happening in today's agriculture is, agriculture is not becoming economically viable for the people. And that is why the problem that is happening is you don't find many people are getting into agriculture. what you will find is so many people are leaving the agriculture. The farmers are committing suicide.
Yeah.
It is said almost 28 people die or 28 people in India commit suicide or related to the agriculture. This is the worst thing that is happening.
This is how frequently?
Huh?
28 people, how frequently?
Daily.
Daily?
Daily. You will see the scientists, the statistics that are given in the Indian parliament about farmer suicide. So they have given year-wise how many farmers are committing suicide. They are in thousands in number every year.
Oh my God.
So why this situation has come? Because of this conventional farming and this kinds of, like, you know, see, first you lost your seed. For the seeds, you are depending upon the corporations. Then fertilizers also, you are depending upon the corporations. And for when the pest attack comes, that time also people keep buying chemical pesticides. So this whole agriculture gets
controlled. So it lost the seeds because people are no longer using natural seeds. That's what you're saying? Because it's become agribusiness now. Okay.
Yeah, it has become agribusiness. So the corporates, they are manufacturing the data, manufacturing the research, and all the farmers, the different governments, then different agriculture universities. So what is being taught is this conventional agriculture, means what the agriculture is happening to now. Say, that is like the chemical farming that is being taught in all the agriculture universities all over the world. And all the nations are thinking by this chemical farming, we will become prosperous. But actually exactly opposite is the way of living. That if you have a small farms and if you do it in organic way, actually the farmer will become prosperous. And when the farmer become prosperous, the country will also become prosperous. So this is what we need to understand. And this is exactly what Prabhupada wanted is, like, you know, you grow all your own food. So you will be secured. Whatever happens in the world, you will not get affected. So that you will be able to peacefully follow your spiritual practices. And this pandemic, that's exactly that has happened. So what we are doing it is, so our aim is to show how farming can become economically viable for the people. If the farming is economically viable for the people, then people can actually live very happily.
Okay.
So that's
now, how I'm trying to, just 1 minute. I'm trying to flow the understand the flow of your thought. So one thing which you established till now is how the current way of living is not sustainable. Even the current way of farming is not sustainable. And on top of that, because farming is not seen as economically viable, so people are leaving. People are either literally leaving their bodies or they are leaving the city, leaving and going to cities or something like that. So now we are going to talk, if I understand right, that, you know, when Prabhupada said that just with one piece of land, 1 acre of land, we can be sustainable. So this seems to run contrary to the current understanding in society. So now what you're saying is how finance farming can be financially sustainable. So how, in a sense, what Prabhupada has said is true when the current economic situation seems to say otherwise. And how it is true, you are going to explain, and you are also going to say show how you have been able to demonstrate that through the rural outreach. Am yes. I understanding it right now?
Yeah, that's exactly.
Yes.
Okay. ISKCON farm means like on ISKCON land, so it becomes institutional farming. So institutional farming will have some advantages, some disadvantages. So institutional farming, like, you know, we do farming here. We document all our processes, and then all our experience that we have about organic farming, we can share with the people who are our neighbors. So when we share this knowledge, then neighbors will also start like having proper organic agriculture practices. So why that is necessary? Because if you want to establish the Varnashram system, then the Varnashram system can be best established in agrarian society. In the urban setting, it becomes little difficult to establish. And most of time you will see Vedic time, it was always a land-based economy. So if you have a land-based economy, then all these different occupations becomes easy to perform. So first, like we started doing our agriculture, and then what we found is that when we started doing our rural outreach programs, we could see like there are people who are surrounding us. One phenomena we observed is like many of the farmers are migrating. They are doing agriculture only in rainy season, 4 months, and after rainy season they go and work as a construction laborers, or they go and work as a bricks making unit. Basically they leave the village. Sometimes they leave, or sometimes the whole family leaves. So then how you will do outreach if the family itself is migrating? Where you will go on tracing them? So then what we told them, why don't you stay on the land, and then we will tell you how you can live off the land. So just kindly do the agricultural practices how we suggest it. So when we did first like the baseline survey of understanding the local situation, because any project you start, you must know the local situation. So we collected all this information, and we could see that some of the farmers were staying around us, because Palghar is like a lot of tribal talukas are there. Many tribals stay in this. And we could find out in our baseline survey, some of the farmer families have less than 10,000 a month, less than 10,000 a year income.
10,000
Can you imagine less than 10 year means how much in a month?
900.
Probably 900 rupees. How much it will convert into dollars?
$15. Not even 15, $12 or something like that. $13-$14. My God.
$12, sir? Dollars. So that's how the people, some people were staying. So then what we thought, like, why are this condition? Because their agriculture practices are wrong. And they are like not given proper guidance.
Okay, just a minute. So now what you're trying, if this is a little surprising for me. Just a minute. So that means you're saying that that agriculture, people who are doing agriculture, that is their life, but sometimes they may not know how to do it well. Then, and we may know it better. So is this knowledge like knowledge which is also, it's agricultural knowledge, but it is not like a common knowledge in the agricultural community today? Is something like that?
I see, it's not like we have invented this knowledge. See, this knowledge was already existing, and this knowledge we got it from like previous two generations. Like I asked a person who is like my grandfather, who is like 80 years old, and they told us how the agriculture was being practiced before Green Revolution. So we just learned from the society itself. But in between, in 1960s onwards, all this Green Revolution and all these chemical fertilizers, the pesticides and hybrids came up, all that thing got washed off. And then people got into a different agriculture patterns. Instead of cultivating what the family needs, they started cultivating different kinds of cash crops. And then for cash crops, they started getting into all these different kinds of agriculture practices which were not sustainable. So we just got the biodiversity concept back, got the sustainability concept back. So what we learned...
So another thing here. So you mean to see this disruption is just like a couple of generations old?
Yes.
So it is not that the British came and plundered India and that time our agriculture got destroyed, or it happened something, but the special big thing is the recently now. Is it like that?
Yes, recently now, say Britishers actually wanted to disrupt our agriculture, but they couldn't do so much. So there was Albert Howard, one of their experts. He came 1905 in India. Britishers told him, you go and improve Indian agriculture. He came and stayed here in India and studied the local agriculture here, went back to UK and improved agriculture over there.
Really?
He has documented, he has written a book, and he said that my gurus in agriculture are these Indian farmers.
What is his name once again?
Dr. Albert Howard.
Albert Howard, okay, amazing.
He written like Agriculture Testament. It's a very famous book, like, no? Often quoted. So Indian agriculture was very sustainable agriculture and satisfying it was there. So then we thought, like, no, how we can make them, like, no, stand on their own field. So at this, I will share something. This is a picture of a farmer. This is a picture of a typical wadi. When it's developed, it will look like. So what you will, there are big trees. These are mango and cashew trees. And in between, they do intercropping. That is either jasmine, mogra, or floriculture, or vegetables. And then they have their rice paddy and others. So you have a long-term crops, that means say mangoes and other things. After 3 years, once a year they will give in. Then you plan your land in a such a way where you have say papaya, banana, who can give once a year income, and the vegetables and the grains seasonally, three times or four times a year, they will give you income. So when you arrange your whole thing in such a way, so there's a long-term income, middle-term income, and short-term income, and you have biodiversity, that will actually increase your agriculture output and you can live off the land. So then...
And all this can grow in the same weather? It doesn't require different weathers for all this?
Agroclimatic zones, the crop patterns will be different.
Okay.
See, our region is a heavy rainfall wetland, so rice hill will come more. A dryland area, like wheat and other crops will come there. Oh, so agriculture is specific. It's a different crops at a different regions will come. So the principle is the same, but you have to apply as per your geographical conditions.
Okay. So now, if I understand right, what you're saying is, so we taught how to establish this wadi concept to people. And you said you learned this from people two generations ago.
Yes.
Oh, okay. And so these are people who, this is not something we have implemented on our farms, or we may have implemented, but this is what you're telling is how this has been implemented under our guidance by the local villagers.
Yes.
Okay.
So like this model has been almost like more than 1,000 farmers, they have adopted this thing. And I will show you how that's beneficial. So typically this is one farmer. His two sons are well educated, but still they want to continue in agriculture. They don't want to take any factory job or any other place job. So that's what I could say is like a success, where the farmer's son wants to do farming and understand it, getting any company job or other things. Now this is like an agriculture output. So this family came in contact with in 2013 and 14. So he was getting 8,800 rupees yearly income from his farm. And then he would go out and do odd jobs. But now you see 2014, he got 13,000, then 15, 16, he got 1,22,000, 16 he came back, and then 2018-19, he has gone up to 2 lakhs rupees. Now I will explain how he achieved that.
It's almost a 20 times increase.
Yes.
That's huge.
So previously he was just taking one crop price outside and working. After that, we told him along with the rice, you grow vegetables also. So next year he got rice plus vegetables. Then next year we told him rice, vegetable and some floriculture. Because what he planted, it start yielding the flowers in 2015-16. So he got rice, vegetable and floriculture. Then in 2016, then he added rice, vegetable, floriculture and cereals as well. And then you will see 2018 and 19, then he had like rice, vegetable, fruit trees, floriculture, cereals and vermicompost. So all the little stream of income from different things eventually made him earn this much from his land. So what we did is just shared some knowledge with him and gave little inputs that he wanted.
So this is amazing. Now, when you explain it in this way, it in a sense seems so like intuitive and simple. But you are saying because the generational contact was lost, so even the farmers for whom this is their livelihood, they didn't know about this, is it?
You see, sometimes what happens is the solution is simple also, but we can't believe like the problem may be complicated.
Okay.
But sometimes it will be such simple as this. Just like see what your great grandfather was doing, simply just do that. Just by city, Vedic way of farming was like was never one thing. As I mentioned, like rice, once upon a time in India, you knew how many varieties of rice was there.
Varieties of rice. That
yes.
means like different brands or?
Different varieties of rice. Like we have a Surti Kolam, then we have Indraini. So different varieties of rice.
Okay. Like Basmati is there.
Yeah, Basmati.
Okay. So how many
yes.
were there?
Yes.
A few hundred or?
Just throw any figure that comes to your mind.
500?
It was 2 lakhs of varieties. Of
2
rice.
Lakh varieties of rice.
Was only there in India. What to speak of China and then Thailand, Sri Lanka and other places. You know that Dr. Vandana Shiva? She
yeah,
is
of course,
like
yeah. Very famous.
Environmentalist.
Yeah, very
she
famous.
She has a Navadhanya society. And in that society, she has she works for this seeds and all that. So all this information she has given in her books. So there was biodiversity of rice. Then we have varieties of millets. In one millet, you take the foxtail millet. There will be, you will find 20, 30 varieties or more than that now. Previously, it must be more. And each variety would have a different kinds of nutrient values. And there is Dr. Devaldev, who is there in Orissa, one single rice scientist. He has got 1,420 different varieties of rice. And he has got a nutrition analysis done for this rice. And many of these rices are having medicinal varieties.
Medicinal, my God.
You have some heart disease, then you have some iron deficiencies, you have some hemoglobin less, or you want to recover from major diseases. After that, you need recuperations. So many varieties of rice was available. Food was medicine that time. So what today's generation is measuring success in terms of yield. You go to any farmer, he will say, kitna production ho gaya? How much did you get from this? We will be always calculating in terms of how much yield you got. But actually, you should be calculating how much nutrient I got from 1 acre of land. And that's what is exactly is needed. Because today, what is happening, in order to earn the wealth, we give up our health. And then to recover our health back, we have to spend all the wealth. So oh, this God. Is how like na, is it today's the society people work. So that's why like so this is how you will see the simple thing, and this is what exactly Srila Prabhupada wanted. Like you grow varieties of things and you become self-sufficient.
So just so, when you say, has Prabhupada actually hinted at this, that we could have biodiversity? Or Prabhupada has given the principles and then...
Yes. Prabhupada said all your necessities will come from the land. And I have still seen farmers in India, only thing that they need to buy from outside is the salt.
Oh, okay.
You can understand, except salt, what are all things you need to eat? Everything.
Vegetables, grains.
Yes, vegetables, oil seeds.
Everything can come.
Everything can come.
And only if you are only if you are selective about particular things, they might not be available. But if somebody is not selective, then whatever is locally available, we can live with that.
See, they were, it was such a scientific, our ancestors knew how to do this agriculture. No matter what kind of rainfall is there, they were always successful. Why? Because one simple farmer in Orissa taught me this technique. Doesn't know how to read and doesn't know how to write. Rose, see, that is foxtail mill ragi. He has three varieties of ragi. One variety comes very good when there is a heavy rain. Another variety comes very good when it's a medium rain. And another variety comes in the very low rainfall area. So rain will be either very heavy, middle, or less. So what kind of rainfall is there, he will always get his crops. That one variety will definitely come. So it's not that he is living off the land and the nature is going up and like, no, there is different climate change and all those things, but still he is successful.
So that's why like, no, for monoculture is destructive. So monoculture is destructive. Yeah, and biodiversity.
Yes,
okay, amazing.
He himself is like no, more than 70 years of old.
Oh.
20 years, you can have a success rate. Like no, 70 years is not like no, he has to go out and bake. Everything he got from his own land, all the grains, the cereals, the oil seeds, the vegetables, everything he got, and some cow milk. And he could live very easily on his land. All the farming techniques. With the so-called today's learned people think he is illiterate. But he has actually mastered the art of living. So that's what like, no? Being like, we need to work is on the seeds. So I will just show you that slide about the seeds.
You seem to have done a lot of research in this field. I said, going to Orissa and meeting farmers over there. So was the inspiration for all this, that Prabhupada's instruction that we can live on the land? And how do we go about implementing that? And to find out ways of implementing that, you did all this research on all the networking.
Yes, because you have to do this. Like if you're doing agriculture, so you must know how to do it. And way to learn is from these people only, who are like the successful models. In theory, they're just giving like living examples. And let's get like the way. So what I want is like about this thing, the seeds, as if I talked about the biodiversity.
Yeah.
Now I will show you that about the seeds that this project that we are working upon. Because what happens is, this is very important for all of us to understand that why we need to work upon the seeds, because now the most of the seeds are controlled by the corporations, multinational companies. And then how you can consider yourself as independent if your country is dependent on someone, some other country or some other corporation for give you the seeds? Your independence is of no use because they can control everything. So that's why, like, no, we thought, like, no, we should have a proper training program for the farmers so that they can grow the seeds properly. It's a science, the how the seed companies are doing it. Similarly, we want to train our farmers in such a way that they can understand the techniques of keeping the seeds in a scientific way so that it goes on, their yield goes on increasing, and we save these indigenous varieties of seeds. So we made like some seed demo plots, then some farmers started like getting training for the seed cultivations. They will grow only for the seed purpose, and then whatever the seeds they have grown up, some farmers will do it for the large scale production, and then we can have a community seed bank. Now what has happened is the people are taking patents for the different varieties of rice and all those things, but actually that's wrong, because a human has not invented those seeds. Those seeds, the Supreme Lord has given it to us, and no scientist can produce these kinds of seeds in the laboratories, which has got so much of nutrition values. And then we can do all these food products and all those from those different kinds of millets in kitchen garden. So what our program is like, na, to have indigenous seeds, which are climate resistant, because all of you know, the seasons are not coming on time. Previously, when I was a school, the 7th June I have seen in Bombay, always rain would start. But now it is not so regular. And all over the world, the climate is changing. And then it should be nutritional superior.
Hmm.
And then farmers should have like seed sovereignty, because they have been keeping these seeds for generations. Why should like somebody get patent and only that one particular person will get right to use those seeds? And by the cultivating these kinds of like you have enhanced livelihood for them. And this is like when first, like when you have a nutritious food, you will your family will become healthy. So what
so
you have to
all
understand,
this is being done in each village separately, or these banks are like for one taluka, one town, or each of this is for
in
one
the
village?
Cluster of the farms, not in the village. It's like a cluster. We make the cluster of the farmers, so they come together. They may be like within the same locality, may not be exactly from that same village, but in that same area.
Come together.
And risk mitigation means like because of whatever climate change that has taken place, the different kinds of pests have come. These indigenous seeds can easily handle all those things. The hybrid seeds cannot handle all those things. And because what happens, these seeds plus like cow dung as a fertilizer, then you grow like in a very, the soil is healthy. Actually, what happens is your health will be equal to the soil health. Because not what has happened is GM seeds, there is like some toxin in that itself. So that toxin goes to the land, the soil gets spoiled, and then if water that is eaten by the cattle, they also get contaminated. The food that you eat, that also get contaminated. So the whole ecosystem is destroyed because of that. So this is how like you need to work upon this. And this is how, like, no, we have done the program, and all those things that we are doing it is mainly so that, like, no, we have devotees who are staying in the cities. Devotees have good food to eat. They need to be health. So the ISKCON farms can produce few things, but we can share this knowledge with the surrounding neighboring farmers. So the farmers, those who come in contact with us, they also start, like, replenishing the nature rather than exploiting the nature. And they get mutually benefited. The people who, those who are staying in the cities, like devotees, will get a non-toxic food, chemical-free food to eat. And then farmers also will be able to take care of their soil better, the water supply is better, air quality is also better. So it's mutual beneficial. Oh, and okay. What happens is, this farmer, when we associate with them, then naturally
About this is a very significant thing, because generally when you talk about farm communities, at least my vision was that say we make devotees, and then devotees come and live on farms, and our devotees start farms, and they have been done, but it is quite difficult in a sense if devotees have lived always in cities for them to come to villages. So in a sense, you are inverting the process, that instead of, say, making devotees and then getting them to become farmers, we say reach out to farmers and then make them into devotees. So that's quite a creative way of doing it.
No, it's a it's a natural, in the sense, like, how many farm communities you can have, and once you buy the farm, then a lot of land management and a lot of
other happens. That's true.
So you, at one hand, you keep on developing the farms, so that becomes like a spiritual center, as well as it can give the good agriculture practices knowledge. And all these people, the farmers, they start these cultivation practices, and then they, when they come to visit our farm to understand the agriculture, naturally we take them to the temple, so we have a nice kirtan, then we give them Bhagavad Gita, and then they go back to their village. So some of the villages are far away and in tribal areas. So then we go there, all the village come together, then they start, like, na, Janmashtami celebrations and different celebrations. Best thing for the tribals is, like, they like to do dancing and they like the singing.
Okay.
So we have a really good, nice dancing sankirtan parties. So we go there, tell them little philosophy, tell them, like, how they can take care of the Tulsi Maharani, and simply just chant this holy name and just take care of the cows properly. Because once you start organic farming, they understand that it cannot be done without the cows. So then they start keeping proper care of the cows also. Because why the cows are in trouble today? Because they are being separated from the agriculture. When cows and agriculture are together, they are mutually beneficial to each other. You can take care of the agriculture also nicely, and that's the way actually you will be able to do cow protection. You cannot do cow protection by just passing the laws or by any other ways. Or you may be able to protect the cows in goshalas, when that's like kind of a temporary situation.
That's not sustainable. It's not naturally sustainable.
Natural sustainable. Actually, the farmers has to keep the cows, and the cows has, they have to understand its importance for the agriculture purpose. So that is the most important thing.
Can you elaborate on this? Actually, there are two, three things I wanted to ask you based on what you said. But last point you said, how exactly is, say, cow protection and agriculture naturally related? Now, Krishna says in the Bhagavata, Krushi Goraksha, he brings both of them together as Vaishya Karma Sabhavajam. So how does, say, agriculture make cow protection viable?
See, the As far as agriculture is, see, whatever grass that grows, whatever weeds are there, you feed to the cows. Cows will give milk, and the cow dung has to go back to the agriculture. So there are various different preparations that you may want to make, like Jivamrut, Dashaparani, then Ghanajivamrut, and different kinds of other things. The best ingredient is cow dung and the cow urine. So cow urine also acts as a deterrent for the pest. It also acts as a hormones. It also acts as a nitrogen. So by making different kinds of combinations, you can make varieties of things by which you can increase the soil fertility.
And all this is like a, this is like modern scientific knowledge, or it is also like making all these components is traditional knowledge?
It's a traditional knowledge.
Oh, okay. So they may not know exactly that this is nitrogen and these things, how it works, but they know it works.
Yes, it knows it works. So what we have to tell nowadays is like, na, we have to tell like, na, this has got N, this has got P, this has got K.
Okay.
Explain it, then how that like, na, educated people can understand it.
But okay.
Many things were happening properly.
That's amazing.
What we are doing it is like, na, so we are teaching them this material level and how to take care of the agriculture, how to take care of other things. That is not sufficient. We have to teach them about the spirituality also. Only when they live the life according to the Lord Krishna's instructions, God conscious way, then only the earth will supply all those things. Simply by your material techniques, things will not happen. So we have to tell them like, this you have to do. That will become your agriculture sustainable. And at the same time, the spiritual level, what is taught in Bhagavad Gita, Annat Bhavanti Bhutani, so that unless you perform this Sankirtan Yajna, then only the Lord will send the rain. Because mainly that for agriculture, rain is very essential, and rain has to come on time. And that is controlled by the Supreme Lord. And only when you are God consciousness, He will give you that. So this wholesome knowledge has to be given to them. And that's how, like, spreading Krishna consciousness, at the same time teaching them how you can live off the land. And then the external things will not trouble you much.
That's remarkable. So then, in a sense, the Krishna conscious outreach is also happening organically. It's
yes.
Like you don't literally go to give them speak. You don't go to preach. You go to help, and in the and while helping them, they associate with devotees and they become, in a sense, inspired. So is it that, say, we offer help only to those people who become devotees, or the help you offer to potentially to anyone, and people naturally reciprocate?
Now, where we see there are sincere people, we offer help.
In terms of, say, like all this knowledge of, say, how to make the wadi, how to have this seed banks and all those things. So those also you, means do you judge the spiritual interest of the people before doing that? Or that you start first directly and then gradually people take up?
First we see the people are sincere. So what we have done is like, when we saw like, as we are developing our Golden Nico Village farm, and we saw the surrounding areas. So naturally we thought like, we should do something for them. Because it's like, whatever you have, you would like to share with others.
Yes.
Previous, our whole Vedic tradition was, the Grihasthas were charitable. And then they would like, before they would take their own prasadam, they would always go and out. And ask, is there anyone who has not taken any food? And only when nobody is there, then only they could take it. So this is a charitable nature was there. So what we thought is like, if we can organize, so we can have some grihasthas, because grihasthas has to find some job. Could take some CSR fund, which is legally available for us for this kind of activities, engage some of our grihasthas doing this kind of things, and that's how we will be able to bring people to Krishna consciousness as well. At the same time, we can create a nice community around us. So that's what sometimes like neighboring some children came to us.
Just 1 minute before you go to that. There's a lot you said. So CSR is corporate social responsibility. So now that means when we started offering all this to people, all these resources, all this help. So it's not necessary that we had to say invest our funds because it was seen as charitable work. So we could also get funds from people. So we give the expertise, we basically took the initiative and then the resources came. Is it like that somewhat?
Yes. We could see like how we can help out because for ourselves also, we also need good food to eat. And yeah, we also need a good people around us. Because if you don't engage them in proper constructive work, they will go for destructive kind of activities.
Yes.
That's how it can be easily done. And what we see is if people are sincere, we go and help. And then sincere people will naturally get attracted to Krishna. And then there are different levels, some pick up very quickly. Some people just remain kind of a very good well-wisher. Some people will do lots of service. So different grades will be there in that. But they will always become very favorable and appreciative of Krishna's devotees. And as soon as you go in the village, all the children and villagers will come and start participating with us in Harinam, or at least Hare Krishna people have come.
Oh, okay.
Activities.
So when you say people are sincere, by sincere, you basically mean that they actually want to, are you talking about spiritual sincerity or material responsibility that if you offer them help, they will take it, or both?
So basically both also, but basically we see that they're sincere to work on the land.
Okay.
Sincerely improve the condition. It's not like some people will just take the help and may not do anything on that. That we have to understand.
Yeah, okay. I think then if they have that sense of earnestness to improve the situation, then they will naturally take up spirituality also, because they will be able to see that this bhakti will also, Krishna consciousness also improve my situation. Yeah. So that's a good starting point. So in a sense, what we are doing is we could say we are integrating compassion and devotion together in the domain of, say, agriculture, isn't it?
Yes, in the domain of agriculture also. And then the family means the family will have a children's. So the children's education also will come. And children's in rural area, many places, the education quality is very low. So sometimes my children who is in 9th standard, but cannot do simple additions also. So that's the level of education is there some places in India. So initially when we came here and we were living, so neighboring children came, can you help me out in some of this mathematics and science? So one or two brahmachari just gave some time. And we could see those children coming for our Jalmashtami festival, taking up some services. Then we saw for a Pushyabhishek, they came on their own, helped us to pluck the flowers and participated in chanting and dancing. So we thought this is also a good opportunity. So through CSR, then we could employ one or a few teachers who help them out in some of their academic studies. At the same time, we have a students' camp at our Govardhaniko village. And these students' camps are very effective in changing the students' attitude. So children come and stay with us for a week. They participate in all of our morning programs, and then we teach them all the Bhagavatam stories. At the same time, we help them a little bit in their academics. And then by end of the camp, like, na, we see many children, they say, like, now, today onwards, na, I will become vegetarian. Some children, like, na, they insist their parents, like, na, buy Bhagavad Gita for me. And then we have seen through these children's, now the parents are also coming to the temple. And through the children's, we have seen the teachers are also coming to the temple. So,
amazing.
Like, na, from children, we went into the parents. From children's, we went into the teachers. And all together, na, we have a nice congregation coming up through this initiatives.
This is amazing. So, normally, what age group children are these?
These are all school children's, basically.
Could be any level, like first, second, third, or like a secondary
level? No, first, at least like na.
Second, higher secondary or secondary?
Say fifth standard. When miss,
fifth
when
standard, okay.
Above age of 10 years of age.
Oh, okay.
Seen like na, because surrounding our eco village, there are not many big colleges or college hostels are there. So we can't go typically our ISKCON youth forum. Then we discuss like na, if there are no colleges, schools are there. So we'll get into the school teaching. And so the school preaching is now we are seeing now 7-8 years. So some of the children's, then they become part of our ISKCON youth forum. Some of the children's like who are good in education, they go for higher studies. And ISKCON youth forum all over India, ISKCON Pune, ISKCON Delhi, there are so many bases in different colleges. So quite like na, a few students of from our neighboring areas could go and stay in the best. So that's how like na, we see the school preaching will eventually, you will get the ready-made candidates for your ISKCON youth forum.
So when you said earlier, this is like a good trajectory they're set on. So when you said earlier, say we help them in, initially the brahmacharis help them in some math or science, and now we have teachers. So is this like a official tuition classes, or have we started a school itself, or is it something, a formal institution, or how are we offering this educational support to these children?
You see, we have a school that's for our
Gurukul
patients. And then we have these teachers who go out to the schools. We have about almost 30 schools. And we go and help them out in teaching science and maths. And then we have them come for residential camps. And when they come to residential camps, then we get opportunity to preach. And the same, because all those teachers are devoted teachers. So they not only teach the mathematics, science, they teach the value education. Value education is that this thing only.
Teaching
consciousness only.
So value education is taught. Value education, we actually go to the schools and teach them directly, or?
Yes, sir. Yeah, go to the schools because we get a very nice response from the teachers because already helping them out in different things.
So they don't feel that, you know, you are better than us and you are showing us down. They're happy to have the help that we are providing.
Okay. Yes. And then, because nowadays, like the schools, they face a lot of different challenges also. Recently, we were invited by the local administration education department because some children committed suicide in ashram schools. So then they said, like, you please tell us like na, how you can help us in students' suicide prevention programs. So we are thinking like na, how to develop a program by which like na, we can help the students. And then we got talent search.
Oh, okay. So
about like na, on an average like na, 1200 to 1300 school, like 1,200 children on an average for last 10 years, they appear from our surrounding area for Gita talent search. And all these
Gita talent search.
Yes.
Okay.
It's like GLC, that's all the work gets done.
Okay.
So we do it in such a way like na, we go and teach the Bhagavad Gita in 5-6 classes. The from first to fourth chapter only, because these are students. We teach only first four chapters, and the exam is there only first four chapters.
Okay.
And that's how
why first four
children,
because it fits in their schedule.
Yeah.
They don't have to study too much.
They don't have to study too much.
Okay.
And we just want to introduce Gita to them.
Okay.
And then what happens is all those children who are successful, who got the prizes, at least now we have about 50 to 60 children, we give them prizes. And then we have a special programs for these children.
Okay.
And that's how like able to keep a good contact with these children as well.
Oh, okay.
And actually become part of our highways.
So you said 1200 students have been participating like this for 10 years almost.
Yes.
So you started all this from which year? All these
like usually it's 2010 we started all our outreach. 2003 we came here in this land.
Okay.
But the budget was very low, very few devotees were there, and we were busy taking care of our agriculture and other things. And when we gained some experience, we started sharing with surrounding areas.
Okay. So now, if I understand right, there are three things happening from what I understood. So first, we go to the villages and we teach them farming. Then they come to the temples and they take up some level of Krishna consciousness. That's one level of interaction between us and the farmers. Then another level of interaction is...
One second. See, we have a systematic program. Whoever we are helping them in agriculture education, we have spiritual programs for them as well. We don't
okay.
leave anyone else. And they do come to the temple as well.
Okay, so we have preachers going there and we do the programs
yes.
also in those areas. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So that's we will not expand if our preachers are not there. We are not going to expand too much. We'll expand to the extent we are able to preach to them through brahmachari preachers as well as gurustha preachers.
Oh, okay. So currently when you say expand, we are doing this in how many places?
First, in mostly majority of our work is in Palghar district.
Okay. That is in the, maybe say.
And in Pune and others, Pune and Satar area also, we are beginning now. Some of our devotees there, they are also working for the farm projects and other. So they are also starting this kind of initiative.
So in a sense, this is a replicable and scalable model, isn't it? What you have done
yes.
over here?
Yes, we want this always is there in my mind. Like whatever we do, it should be replicable. Otherwise, it's of no use. Like,
oh, okay.
Work only in specified conditions only.
So now, the Govardhan Eco Village, if we consider... There are many parts of it. So there is the resort part, there is the Vrindavan Gardens part, and then now the Bhagavatam Institute is there, all that. But when we talk about replicating this, just if we have a farm project with a farm, and then we have devotees who go out. So for the replicability of this particular model, we may not need like a huge amount of investment, isn't it?
See, as far as other things are concerned, it depends from the local situation. And
yeah.
Table is agriculture part.
Yeah, of course.
Rural outreach.
Yeah, right. I understand. No, so overall, Govardhan Eco Village, because there are so many other things, the logistical requirements are high. But
yes.
for the particular rural outreach, in one sense, the investment may not be very high in that sense.
Yes, like we have many temples here. Other farm projects can have one simple temple also. So that will depend on the local leaders and local situations.
Oh, okay.
The agriculture will remain the same. And cows, agriculture, and then sharing our knowledge with others. That can.
So we have, so I was talking about these three things. First is what you mentioned. At one level, we hold up, have a contact with the farmers, teach, help, give them some assistance in farming in a way that is financially sustainable. And then we also have programs in those areas. So we help them both financially and spiritually. And but the initial
agriculture, agriculture is not just not a financial, it should be ecological, environment friendly agriculture, sustainable agriculture with all indigenous practices, and that will activate it into financial system.
So when I said financial, it's not that I basically we help them financially means we help them to live in a way that is sustainable, and it is financially as well as ecologically sustainable. That's what, okay.
Yes.
So that is one level of interaction with the farmers. Then another is what you talk about with children. Now, usually, and you said that through the children, you are also getting these parents. So you mean these children are often different from the farmers for whom we are doing the Wadi and other projects. Is it?
Yes, this children's like, na? The schools like, na?
Okay.
Are there in some towns like, na? So we have a,
okay, okay.
We have Wada town. So some schools are there. But most of the children are from farming background.
Okay.
And like the farmers to who we are trying is those are below poverty line people.
Oh, those with whom you are doing the Wadi project. Yeah, you can make that out. And if they're
having this... a certain criteria. So criteria is like, na, those are below poverty line, very poor people with whom we are interacting.
Oh, okay. And when we go to the schools and you say you have this, you teach the Gita, are these Hindu schools or even in the government schools, you can go and directly teach the Gita? Isn't secularism
is like here? Mostly there are government schools only, very few private schools here, like the Jilla Parishad schools, they're government schools only.
Okay. But then there is no concern of secularism. How are you teaching a religious text or something like that?
98% is no problem. Only some principles, sometimes they create trouble. Well, what I did is when in the beginning, I went to the principals meeting where the all principals come together and gave them presentation. And that's how then officially permission was given by the principals association. And got it. But sometimes some schools, sometimes there is some issues. Then we go to the next school.
Okay. So when you give the presentation, you said how this will help the students to, means yes. What was the thrust of the presentation basically that convinced
basically
them?
How the Gita is relevant in today's world and how it helps actually for us to progress as a human being and how you can like live a good life and how it will be like useful, how students will not go astray in a wrong way.
Actually,
person means automatically he will be away from all kinds of vices and all those things.
And how is the overall demographic here? Are most people say Hindus, or do we have people from other religions, and do they oppose us? How is this, that aspect?
There are, that's always like other faiths are also there surrounding us. But we are not so much affected.
Oh, okay. So naturally, I suppose the students who get connected with us, they will probably be from the broad, our faith itself.
Other people also join to our programs as well.
Oh, is it? Okay. Interesting. Yes. Yeah, I remember long ago, I saw one picture of, like we had this National Gita League kind of things. Some Muslim girl had won the international prize or something like that also. It was quite a newsworthy item. So
I've seen some of our other people came and stayed in our residential camp over here also.
Oh, really? Okay.
Parents also came and they appreciated our work and they took Gita and all other things from us as well.
Oh, that's remarkable. And there is sometimes a lot of concern in some circles that there's a lot of, say, Christian conversion happening in the rural and tribal parts of India. Is that a significant challenge for us in the vicinity over here?
This definitely, there is a presence of other faiths are there, and but one thing you need to understand is like this people have reached to the very remote corners where it's not easy to go. Like means the road is there, then after that then you go on motorcycle, and after that even motorcycle also can't go, then you have to walk. So in that remote villages also, these people are there for many decades ago. So that means that time the facilities were even more austere than what is there now. I know what was the condition of our main highway about 20 years back, 30 years back. So that time also, these people of this faith have gone and approached into this remote area, and they have tried to help some other people. So for we also need to go and reach out to these people. Our people also need to stay with these people and understand their difficulties, interact with them, and then share our knowledge with them, and then share some resources with them. Otherwise, like na, how we will just keep complaining of other things. We need to reach out to these people and understand their difficulties and share our higher consciousness with them. Then I don't think, why will they go somewhere else?
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah. In a sense, we can, I like this whole approach that in a sense, whoever reaches people the first and whoever actually helps them, if they are putting in the efforts, they will get the rewards. So rather than blaming them, we can say, we can take it as an inspiration for us to reach out more.
Yes, that's the main thing. Like, no, we need to reach out, because how many of our people are willing to stay in those kinds of austere conditions where there won't be even a proper thatch hut is also there. So in the remote locations, it's a very austere life and tough challenges they've faced it. So we also need to take that much of hard work, sincerity, and dedication work. Then definitely people will listen to us and take us seriously.
So that is so true. Actually, I was reading a book about the spread of, say, there is a book written called The New Christendom. So in America, Christianity is declining. So what they're saying is, in Africa and Asia, Christianity will spread. And then from here, we will have people coming. Because in America, not many people want to, especially in Catholics, they don't want to become priests and stay unmarried. So in many American churches now from Asia, they're importing priests over there, because they are shortage of priests. So they're saying that that's how it will spread. So there in that book, I read that, at least this is their claim, I don't know how true it is, that it said that we have translated the Bible into more dialects, Indian dialects, than the Gita has been translated. So it shows in a sense their dedication. So one question.
Yeah, because they have their places of worship in a very remote areas. And I have seen some of my friends, when they were traveling, there's no other place to stay but in those places of worship, and those people were accommodated there. So fact that they went inside and made these kinds of facilities, we also need to go and make all sorts of facilities. Then only like people will take us seriously. And people are, whoever it reaches out to them, they will follow them.
Yeah.
So the point is, go and reach out.
This is a very practical reality. And this raises maybe as a little volatile question, that at a time when people are in need, can we rigidly differentiate between material and spiritual? Because in some ways, if you see this whole idea that at one level in our movement, we don't want to get into philanthropy, because we want to focus on spiritual outreach. But ultimately, we have to meet people where they are at. And when we give them what they need, then as from your experience, as you said, they'll become more open to what is their ultimate need. In some ways, we have to address their immediate need. Then they become receptive to their ultimate need. So, like you said, other faiths have done that quite a bit. They offer help at a humanitarian level. And then people turn toward them or get converted. So how do we do this balance between, say, helping people at a material level and then doing spiritual outreach? How do we balance that?
Philanthropy is one thing, but what I say, like, the grihasthas has to be charitable. Because if you see, as per Vedic Dharma, it's the duty of grihastha to be charitable. And especially, like, as far as the food is concerned, that's a basic thing. Like, in villages, you walk into any house, no matter how poor that house is, they will offer you something, because food is there abundant in their house. And they have been taught in the families, whoever comes to your house, you must feed them. I will show you one example. Once I was stuck on the highway, traffic jams, and we're just stuck there for a long time. So some of us, we got down on the road. So the car who was next to us, he also got down. And then you see on the highway, there are so many construction laborers working. And they have, like, a small plastic cover. And one family was making on the wood nice bhakris, the chapatis. And a person from this next, my neighbor, like a car, now he just waited there. And that's a hot on the wooden fire that it was being made. He was so tempted. Immediately, that woman fed him, like, 3-4 rotis along with the sabji. And that fellow wanted to give some Lakshmi money. The family refused it. He said, like, no, you came to our place. How can we take money for the food? So that's how the rich India's culture is.
These are poor people, like I said, on the street.
These are the poor people, don't even have their own house. They just work on the road construction. And if they don't work, at the end of the day, they will not have anything to eat. But they also felt to be charitable. So that's what we see, like, na, initially when we came, one of our neighbor came, he had a cancer and he had to be operated, and he needed, like, na, almost 1 lakh rupees. So then we arranged, like, na, through our devotee doctors in the government hospitals, his operation can be done. So this is not philanthropy, like, na, this is, like, na, just a common sense. Like, na, if people come to you for help, then you have to help them. So that's how, like, na, to be, you have to understand, like, na, grihasthas has to do some charity. And this charity is necessary. So those people on within us, like, na, whatever they need, we just help them out a little bit. And at the same time, by giving them some material help, we give them the spiritual help also, by which, like, na, they also understand, like, na, both the things are essential. So if you just the philanthropy, that may not be this thing, but if it is, like, how Srila Prabhupada himself started in Mayapur, when he saw the poor child was eating in the garbage and fighting with the dog, immediately he said, like, we should start the Annakshetra, we should start, like, giving prasad. So, like, na, when you are prosperous or you have some means, you need to share with those people who absolutely don't have anything. And at the same time, do it in such a way that you can you elevate them spiritually as well.
So this is a very striking difference you are making between philanthropy and charity. So charity, if I understand the way you are using it, it is a natural human expression of, say, concern or caring for others. And it's a duty of a kshatriya, a duty of a grihastha, rather, householder. Whereas, if I understand right, philanthropy basically means like a organized, institutionalized effort to focus almost exclusively on people's material needs. Is that how you're differentiating it? Is charity more spontaneous?
Yes.
And philanthropy is more institutionalized?
It's more spontaneous in the sense like you see, it was not only in India, in outside India also, like whenever travelers would go, we have read in His Holiness Bhakti Charu Maharaj's when he was traveling to the West, as well as others, like the villagers, when they saw that the traveler has come, they naturally offered some food to him. Right now also, if you go for walking in Chardham Yatra, in Badrinath, Kedarnath, in all those areas, these are very remote area, there are not much hotels. You walk all the day, end of the day, you reach some village. Naturally, the villagers will come and see how many people have come on pilgrimage. Immediately, they will arrange some food for them. They take it. Next day morning, they eat something and then they start walking ahead. So naturally, this system exists. So those are like poor people staying in a mountain. But still, they know this is the way the pilgrims go. And village on their own, they have arranged a place for stay. On their own, they have arranged like, turn by turn, we will feed the people who are coming to our villages.
Yes, amazing. You know, so in a sense, we are simply continuing what is the part of not just Indian culture, but like a spiritual, because not necessarily spiritual, just a caring culture or human culture that was there, in the past. My grandfather, he came from a quite underprivileged family. So he was in Andhra, then he came to Mumbai for studying. So he told me that when he was in Mumbai, they didn't have like hostels and system like that. So they would just stay in a small place and he would go to different houses nearby and they had like a turn. Oh, these are students who have come to stay over here. So we will feed the students every day. So there are five students. So Monday you go to this house, Tuesday you go to this, Wednesday you go to this house. So it is quite, I was touched to hear that. So in a sense, this is a part of our culture.
Yeah, definitely part of our culture. And that's how all the students used to go. This day, this house, this day, that house, this day, that house. And that's how they all shared. So previously,
so it is a common system, you're saying. It is not just like my grandfather's experience or not a special experience. You're saying it is a widespread system?
It was the system existing in Indian villages for ages together.
Oh.
Because that was a sharing culture was there.
Okay.
And what happens is after industrial revolution, the people have started thinking what is for me. But before that, they always thought in how I can share my things with others.
So just to conclude this point about philanthropy, so if I understand right, Prabhupada's concern, when Prabhupada spoke something sometimes negatively about philanthropy, it was primarily, the idea that philanthropy alone will solve the world's problems and there is no need for spirituality. Like manav seva hi madhav seva hai. So the idea is that there's no need to do madhav seva. We'll just do humanitarian work and there's no need for devotional outreach or devotional connection to be established. So his criticism was not primarily for helping people in a charitable way. It was like doing only that and thinking that this will replace spiritual outreach. And when he was concerned about devotees doing it, his concern was that we shouldn't become just mundane welfare workers that consume all our energy and we don't do any spiritual outreach. But what you are doing is, it's organic. So in a sense, when we help each other, we can't help somebody. We can't rigidly separate, I care only for your soul. I don't care for your body. We care for them holistically and they also reciprocate. Am I understanding right what the vision over here is?
Yeah, that's exactly. Our prime focus is spirituality. At the same time, whatever is necessary, we need to do, because you are staying in a village and your neighbor comes for a help, any neighbor will help it. Just like I remember when the first day I went to Down Farm, which was there, it was just a wild forest was there. So immediately neighbor, he put a pipeline for us, gave us you are staying here, so I will give water to you. And then he would ask whether you have anything, whether you have one time he gave wheat to us, and all other whatever grains that he had in his house. See, he was a very simple farmer, but when he saw our situation, we are just beginning, he also helped us. Now, when I have a lot of facilities, then naturally, when there is a need for others, I do reciprocate accordingly. And they also reciprocate by participating in our spiritual activities, when the large crowd comes for Janmashtami, they volunteer for different services. And then they bring some gifts, whatever they grow, vegetables or flowers for the offering for the deities. So all those things is you need to stay in a village, just like a family, and help out each other when there is a need.
Oh, beautiful. So this is adding another dimension to it, that if something is a part of the village culture, like naturally helping each other, and if we go and stay in a rural area, and if we don't do it, then in a sense, we are disrupting things over there. It's not only not compassionate, but it is also disruptive. So that's what even, as you said, even poor people are doing that for each other when there's need. So if we, as you said, if we have resources, we should also. That's true. So overall, the local people now, so you said there are different gradations. Some become devotees, some do services, and some remain favorable. Have we also got some hostility from some elements, or not so much?
Yes, to a certain extent, it will always remain, because there are some people who don't get their commissions, or they don't get their contracts for material supplies and all that. So in today's world, there will be some people who will create trouble for you, and there will be some people who will help you. So always these two kinds of people will always remain, and you have to just live with it.
Okay. So now when I thought of people becoming opposed to us, I was thinking more in terms of economic reasons is understandable sometimes. But one of the awards we got was also because of, say, developing eco-tourism in a sustainable way. So now these awards we have got, are they for all this kind of reaching out to people and training them in sustainable things, or different awards are for different things?
Different awards are for different things, green buildings, one for water harvesting system, one for agriculture. So different subjects we got different awards.
Oh, okay. And but in a sense, people have been, just by our being here, the local people also must have been benefited in some way financially also, apart from our directly offering help, just because now so many people visit and travel. And so in a sense, I read about Mayapur. There's a book about Hare Krishnas in India. So they talk about how just by the presence of Mayapur, the whole place has developed quite a bit. The same with Vrindavan also. When our temple came up, that part of Vrindavan developed quite a bit. So now these are already holy places, but in a sense, this must be, there is no other reason for people to come here, but it is primarily because of us, a lot of people are coming. So development must also happen that way, isn't it?
Yes, a lot of activities goes on, and naturally the people prosper around us, and they get comment, or they get lot of service contacts and all those things.
Yeah.
done is like, you know, we are doing eco-friendly constructions and we are trained some of our villagers in eco-friendly constructions. So they go all over Maharashtra or even out of Maharashtra also. And we are trained them to take the contracts for the eco-friendly construction work. So like that, plenty of the villagers also get.
Amazing. And so when we do all this, at one level, people are, as a financially overall, they are benefited also, apart from spiritually. But I was talking about opposition in terms of, say, we do get religious opposition, maybe not so much for other religions, but even people may have their own forms of worship. There might be some people whom they consider as God, or they worship various devatas. So how receptive are they to worshiping, to practicing Krishna consciousness? And how do we deal with any potential conflicts? Or say their local festivals which go on?
We are very sensitive to their needs and their faith. And what we do is like, as we go to their house for say local festivals like Ganesh Chaturthi and all that, because what happens is Jalmashtami, all of them, they come to visit. Jalmashtami, we go to the village, before Jalmashtami, go to the villages, have Harinam Sankirtan, and then we announce like, no, this day Jalmashtami is there and kindly all of you will come. So a lot of people from different surrounding villages, they come. And then we would like to reciprocate by visiting those villages in Ganesh Chaturthi festival. So we visit them in, that's like the major festival in Maharashtra.
Yeah, huge.
As we go to the villages, so naturally like the immediately they will say like, so you have come, kindly do some kirtan. So then we always go in a groups. So then we have some kirtan for the people over there. Because in Maharashtra, Ganpati means if you go to any family, all the relatives and friends will be there. So like the whole family and relatives, everybody will be together. So in one shot, like, na, you get so many people. So then sometimes some places they just tell you to chant. Some places they say, okay, you chant, as well as like, na, you give some talk. And then sometimes like, na, they say like, my the boy is going to college and he's facing his difficulty. So then we can offer him the Krishna conscious advice. So like this, we are able to build up a good rapport with them as well. Mm-hmm. So most villages, people keep waiting. They know before Jalmashtami, they will come and do some kirtan and invite us. And as we go there, then they will come to our villages. And in Ganpati festival, you can walk in any house without any restriction, without any invitations. And then they greet us nicely. We do kirtan in their houses. And then as per the situation, some places we give elaborate talk, or sometimes we give a short talk.
So basically, when you do kirtans, do they ask us to Ganesh kirtans, or we can do Hare Krishna and our kirtans? It doesn't make much difference for them.
Usually we do Hare Krishna, like, no, they just ask for kirtan. Okay. And in the just can say like glorify Ganesh in
little. Oh, so you, when you say you are sensitive, that means when they are celebrating Ganesh worship, we don't have to bring in the idea of who is supreme or whatever. That is more of a, like, a, we are going to them. They have invited us. So that's more for, say, developing a relationship rather than specifically preaching about who is the ultimate object of worship. So Desh Kal Patra we see, and then accordingly we present.
Because we are relatively new here in this area. Like, now we are 20 years, but like we started this program right from the beginning itself. So this is like, you know, going and creating a rapport. So then what happens is that the family, like, you know, their relatives will be staying at a different villages. So we invite them to our temple. So they know us. So naturally, like, you know, when they come to our temple, they buy books, they take prasad. They attend kirtan. If the lectures are going on, they hear. So this is how, like, na, we connect them to our temple as well.
So it's so important to actually know what is to be done when. So it means what kind of out sensitivity, I would say, means that you know what to speak when or what is the purpose of a particular level of connection. So as you're saying, later when they read books and they come to us, they may naturally evolve spiritually. So we have never had in that sense any conflicts because of whatever they are worshipping before and what we worship, what our Krishna worship. So we have avoided that conflict, isn't it?
Yes, we just say like, no, kindly just add this Hare Krishna Mahamantra and then kindly visit our temple, kindly participate in our festivals. And then naturally, as they associate with the devotees, eventually the things become very clear to them. So some religious like, no, they have read full Bhagavatam, they have read full CC, they know what is what. And they are the ones who are our advocates. So I don't have to directly get into the conflict with others. As you just make like a few people who philosophically very sound. And a local person in that local village, when he speaks, then it has got a better effect.
Amazing. So it's very, it's, we are like enhancing their faith. We are not disturbing or damaging their faith in any way. And that's beautiful. Now, I read in Chaitanya Shikshamrita that Bhaktivinoda Thakur also says that a Vaishnava can participate in three kinds of festivals. One, he says, is the worship of Krishna and Vishnu. That is where the heart of the Vaishnava longs to be. But he said there can be other religious festivals. In that time, Durga Puja was quite big. And he says a devotee can worship there, but a devotee can go to partisanship festivals. But a devotee understands that this is ultimately, that ultimately Durga gets a power from Krishna. And then he also says, there can be secular festivals, like say social occasions or local festivals, and devotee can participate in that also as a matter of duty. So what you're saying is, what you're actually doing has precedent in our tradition also, our tradition's teachings. Now, when we have all this going on, do we also have, like you said, programs regularly going on in people's places? And are the two yes. well coordinated? Say, like where we go, but you said that the Monday program we do for people who are below the poverty line. So when we go to the same villages and do programs, so do they themselves become the host for the program or somebody else becomes? And so are the two like tightly coordinated or broadly coordinated?
So like we have a different devotees taking care of different preaching programs of different levels. So some devotees take care of like school preaching well, some are focusing on the big villages and some are focusing on like to whom we are helping out and all that. So different network of different devotees taking care of like different varieties of things. There are a few colleges also. So some devotees are dedicated for preaching to the youths. So whatever category is, we have a different devotees who are taking care of that.
Okay. So, and I was reading about the outreach levels. I heard that there are like almost 100 devotees who have taken initiation and there were 1,000 people come for yatras and they hold yatras. So it's a substantial outreach happening.
Yes, definitely.
Oh, amazing. And there was one thing in that which you mentioned, that there is also programs for women's empowerment. Now, what exactly does that mean? Because sometimes Prabhupada said that women should be protected and they should stay under the protection of a family member, a protective male family member. So women's empowerment, how is that compatible with, say, what Prabhupada wanted?
So what we have to understand is this woman empowerment is in the rural settings. And in rural area, like if you take agriculture, 50% of agriculture work is done by women. So it's like family unit. Some jobs are performed by men person and some jobs are performed well by the females. And then we have got like different cottage industries kind of things, where we train like say 5 to 10 women come together and jointly they do some activity, just like making jewelry or making some diyas for Diwali, or they make from the gobar the gobar agarbattis, or they make some danta manjan, like some powder for washing teeth, all those sorts of things. So by that they get, all of them, they get small income, which, and usually this simple woman, they use this income mainly for some health needs, or sometimes for like children's marriages, or sometimes for like children's education. So it's not like, no, the woman becomes independent of that. And then usually what happens is the woman starts earning little good, then she gets more respect in the family, and she gets like, no, more sane decision making of the families. And they never become like sort of like independent of anything. Actually, then many times what happens is like male member, if he's addicted to different vices like drinking alcohol and all that, so this supplementary income which woman gets, she is able to take care of her family in a proper way. So these are like already different kinds of things that was naturally existing. So we just help them how they can do that properly. And that additional income is usually used for the family needs.
Okay. So when you say we help them, we provide them the facilities, or we provide them training, or both?
Trainings is like how you come together, and then how all of you together can do some savings. And then how all of you, when they come together, then they discuss about how to take care of the health also. Then they decide like, suppose in a group there are 10 ladies are there, and 3 ladies have some urgent things to work out. Now whom to give priority? And then those who are taken loan, then how, what manner they should repay it. So all those kind of things we help them. And then some sort of documentation is also there, because if they keep documentation, government gives a lot of loans or interest-free loans and so many schemes that are there for which they become eligible.
So the so when you say women's empowerment here, it is not so much to something which is going to disrupt the family, but it actually help the family to function better, isn't it? So
yes, that's what definitely happens. Because many times what happens is if the male member is addicted,
yeah, you mentioned that,
other vices, then when the woman has got some economic power, then she can nicely take care of the family.
Yeah.
And then, husband also then understands the value of them, and then they're like, the way they treat the woman's also becomes different then.
Oh, okay. So in a sense, this is actually going to address many problems. If the women are empowered in this way, the problems of, say, water domestic abuse or something like that, the woman also has, as you say, greater say in the life, and things get addressed. So normally when we, so I was asking that, is this done by brahmacharis or grahasthas, or do we have like female employees for this? Who does all this?
We have a trained female devotees
okay.
who this job.
And now do we do all this through ISKCON, or are we doing this through some sister concern? Govardhan Eco Village itself is under ISKCON, isn't it?
Yes. It's, so we do it like together only, all these activities.
Okay. So Govardhan Eco Village is, if I understand right, it's a farm community under ISKCON.
Yes.
And through the, and along with that, we are doing all these other activities. And say roughly, if we consider the whole Govardhan Eco Village, how much percentage of the devotees here are involved in this rural outreach? Is this like a major thing, or there are multiple things happening in this small and a one?
See, it's a multiple level. Like many brahmacharis are involved in preaching. Then, as far as like the technical knowledge about agriculture sharing is done by like a team of almost 12 to 15 people, and
okay.
Rise of devotees as well as non-devotees.
And so this is the
team is also different. Like, about team of 5-6 people.
So this is all these are people employed by the Govardhan Eco Village?
Yes.
Okay. And their needs are taken care of through the CSR and other things like that?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So, and say now if some of our audience wants to say, if they want to know more about this, they want to learn more about it, somebody wants to replicate this, do they get all the information on the net, or can they contact you, or do you have like a some department or some assistant who can help people learn more about this?
So some information is available on our websites, and for different queries like construction can be answered by some departments. Sustainability, there is a different departments.
Okay.
So if they can write it website, then they will direct it to different devotees who are concerned with those services.
Okay, so each of these is in its own way specialized, and then you have particular people. Yeah, yeah, yes. I could make out that. And overall, you started by talking about Prabhupada's vision. So, but has Prabhupada given specific instructions about how farming, say farm communities are to be developed, or how rural outreach is to be done? Or it's more like he has given the seeds and then we water them and then they grow. So you see the current success as a manifestation of, like you started by talking about how Prabhupada had that vision and that vision. So could you like draw a circle between say what was Prabhupada's vision and how all this has manifested? That could be like a concluding point.
So Prabhupada gave various instructions for the farm projects in New Vrindavan, Gitanagari, in India, Hyderabad, and other places. So one thing was like the devotees, those are staying on the land, they live sustainable life. That's like one type of farm communities, we can say. And then another farm communities where Prabhupada said like the farm communities can grow things and they supply to the city temples, all the grains and milk. So different models, he explained it. So different farm communities will come under like different stress that they give. At the same time, like in Hyderabad, like Shri Prabhupada wanted, like we help surrounding farmers as well. So that's how like we see our rural outreach is definitely like within the objectives of ISKCON, like bringing members closer to Krishna. At the same time, like how they will live a natural life. So we have to teach like outside of ISKCON, like outside of a farm community, at material level also, we need to teach them how like they will do sustainable agriculture, because today's the government as well as the agriculture universities, corporations, they are promoting agriculture which is not sustainable in long run. And that's why Prabhupada knew it very well. He wanted like agriculture plus cow protection there together, and in sustainable way we can do it. So we have to materially, we have to teach them how they can do farming in a sustainable way. And at the same time, we teach them the spirituality as well. Like how they can become obedient to the laws of Lord Krishna, like how they can be live the life as per the instructions that are there in Bhagavatam and Srimad Bhagavad Gita. Because only when people live God conscious life, then only a chance like they can have meaningful life.
True.
So both the ways is a need for them to be trained.
Yeah, maybe just a couple of last questions. So in principle, how, like I talked about earlier, there is a difference between, say, living naturally and living in harmony with nature according to Krishna's guidelines. So how much in principle is your model anti-technology or pro-technology, or what kind of technology do you say, you talk about water harvesting at one place. So how much are you, say, for or against technology?
Let's say we use optimum use of technology, appropriate use of technology, because what I see that our farming project should help in outreach, help in changing the lives of people, and people come to Krishna consciousness. Like through farm project, we should be able to preach. So whatever is necessary, we can do that, because you could establish maybe a model which will be very not much technological, these things, but how much is your outreach? So I think Prabhupada will be happy to see like more and more people come to Krishna consciousness. At the same time, more and more people become like convinced about simple way of living. They don't work hard, unnecessarily hard, for acquiring the artificial necessities of life, which actually they don't need. And that way, like simple living, high thinking should be the main motto of the project. And if people can, like you see that we have a Hungary farm project, and you can see like so many visitors, they come, and so many people who otherwise wouldn't come to the temple to visit farm projects. So like here also we are seeing, we have a Chopati temple, and next to our Chopati is a cathedral school, which is one of the like a very prominent school in South Bombay, and many eminent citizens, like rich people, children go to the school. They never come to our Chopati temple, which is just less than 5 minutes drive. But they bring their students here to Govardhan Eco Village almost every year, and they learn about the natural way of life. Like they see about agriculture, then they see about the cows, then biogas and other sustainable practices. And in spite of like it's a convent school, and most of the staff is this thing, still they come here. And in the end, like students end up buying our books and understand about us. So that's how I see like the farm projects also should become preaching projects and attracts those kind of sections of the people who would otherwise may not visit a typical ISKCON temple.
Oh, okay. That's remarkable. Nearby school children coming here, not there. So if I understand right, the answer to the technology is that we don't obsess over technology. Our purpose is not to go against technology. Whatever is required, we use it. Whatever the farmers require, they may use it. The point is that they should become, say, at one level financially sustainable, and they should grow spiritually. So earlier when you talked about the not using pesticides, insecticide or other things, and for example, not using Terminator seeds, that is not primarily because it is technology and we are opposing it. It is primarily because that is not a way that is even economically sustainable. What to speak of spiritually, what to speak of ecologically sustainable. So it's not opposition to technology per se. It's more opposition to unsustainability.
It's a very if you talk about Terminator seeds, genetically modified seeds, you are simply tampering with the nature, and it is environmentally not suitable, ecologically it is not suitable, it is toxic, it's going to be harmful, and economically it's also proven that it is disastrous, because you see this situation of farmers in Maharashtra who are cultivating the BT cotton, their land has become toxic, and that's the belt where you will find many farmers are committing suicide. So that's why it's a very harmful technology, we can say, tampering with the nature. So those kind of trade, it's absolutely unnecessary.
Oh, okay. So basic technology, like you said, roads being constructed, there being electricity, bore wells, those kind of things, if that's what is, that can make their life, like needs and comforts, that's not a problem then.
Yes.
Okay. So I think this is Prabhupada's principle of Yukta Vairagya again. Whatever is required, we use it in Krishna's service. This is amazing, Prabhu. I mean, and not only is it a whole universe of how the rural world and the devotional world can be married together. That's what as universe has emerged through our discussion. It's amazing. Thank you very much for sharing your wisdom and realizations. And it's been very inspiring talking with you. Usually at the end of the talk, I try to summarize. And then if you have any concluding words, you can share. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay. So today we discussed about broadly sustainable living and rural outreach. So we started by talking about the various remarkable awards that have been won. And then you mentioned about the importance of eco-friendly living, how it all started with Prabhupada's vision. Right in the early days, 1966, we started ISKCON. Within a couple of years, Prabhupada had new Vrindavan. And so he wanted devotees to, he wanted farm communities basically. And then, so he said that people, devotees, a person can live simple 1 acre of land and they can provide for all their needs. So now why would anyone want to do that? For that, we discussed about, you mentioned about what is wrong with today's living. So we are in many ways destroying the ecology and what we're doing is not sustainable. So you talked about the hierarchy of needs, then comforts, then luxuries, then prestige, you could say lifestyle products or something like that. And then beyond that is greed. So need and even comforts can be provided for in nature reasonably. But beyond that, when we start doing, then we are exploiting Mother Nature. And then that is unsustainable, that is destructive. And then we had this discussion about how is nature kind? So you said how even weeds have value. They are not just something to be torn apart. And then this utility of the various things in nature, that cannot be perceived if there is emphasis on monoculture. So when there's biodiversity, then that the value of different things can be appreciated. And so when agriculture becomes agribusiness, then it becomes monoculture and then it is not sustainable. And it was quite revealing when you that you started learning about how agriculture can be done sustainably, how people can live off the land, when today it seems that it is so difficult to live and people even commit suicide. It was shocking to know that only 28 people commit suicide every day. So then how is it possible? So you said that it is, that knowledge is there, but it is lost. And relatively speaking, it was lost just two generations ago, and during the Green Revolution, post-independence. And pre-independence, when the Britishers tried to improve our agriculture, they learned from it and they were impressed. Actually, the Indians are doing much better agriculture. And you said that, what is that, 4 lakh, was it? 4 lakhs wheat, no, rice or wheat. We had varieties?
2 lakhs varieties of rice.
Rice, that's remarkable. And then, so we talked about how, what knowledge was there within the country, within the, say, farmers 2-3 years ago, through various places you have learned that, and then you have created a resource bank or a team who can go and teach this to the local villagers. And so mandi involves they have, say, long term, which is like, say, 3 years 4 years, like mangoes, then medium term, say, banana and guava, and then short term, like grains and flowers and vegetables. So when they do all this, then they make it sustainable. And then also it's remarkable that you could have different varieties of grains, same grain, and some will grow in when there's a lot of rain, some in medium rain, some when it is less rain. So within nature itself, there is, so even farming doesn't have to be like completely be at the mercy of nature, in the sense that whatever way nature does, we can still be sustainable financially. That was, and then you talked about this Mandi project where you go and train people, and then their income has almost increased 20 times in less than a decade. And it was shocking to know that the people live something like 8,000, 9,000 rupees a whole year. And that's a whole family. It's unbelievable how much it is. And then we went to the, so how this outreach grows is, we help them in various ways to make their lives financially sustainable. Then they don't go away, they stay over there. Otherwise, even if we go and preach to them, if after 4 months of farming, remaining 8 months, they have to immigrate somewhere else to get some construction job or something, then we can't even do outreach to them. So when they live over there, at one level, you know, as devotees, we can live on farms. So devotees can become farmers. That's one way to have like farm communities. Another way is that we can also have farmers who become devotees. And that is much bigger. That is, in one sense, scalable and replicable. And that's where we have had almost like 1,000 people coming for yatras, more than 100 becoming initiated. So within that, as we connect with them and help them practically, they come to our temples, they've come to our festivals, we have local programs going on over there. And your basic criteria when you offer assistance to people is that they're sincere. Sincere means they really want to improve their life, they're committed to their agriculture work. And then they grow spiritually at various levels. Initiated devotees, doing volunteers, or like well-wishers. And then we talked about the school outreach, that the education standards is quite poor, and some of our brahmacharis helped the children, say secondary or higher secondary. Then they were very grateful. They started participating in our programs. And now we have, was it 1,200 you say, students every year coming for the for the Gita talent search exam. That's a brilliant way of actually teaching them Gita and also getting them to study and then come to the temple and get rewards. And you're creating a trajectory for them for their spiritual growth lifelong. And they can join the youth forums and other places. And through them, their parents and their teachers are also coming. And because we present the Gita as a book which can add value to people, to make them better citizens, better human beings, better people. So you can address the worries about secularism and you can go to most schools. And then we talked also about the concept about humanitarian work quite a bit. So you mentioned that rather than say blaming or complaining that some other faiths are converting, we can see that they are actually extending themselves and reaching. And if we do that, then why would people go over to some other faith? And then when we go there with respect to helping them, we talked about the difference between, say, charity and philanthropy. The charity is more a natural human compassion. You gave several moving examples of how you said that there's people who didn't even have a home to stay. They are offering several bhakris to passersby who had stopped over there. So if we are in a village culture and we have been gifted things, then we should, it's natural that we should share with others. And through this, when people are, it's part of our traditional culture. It's a part of our even now present village culture that people help neighbors. And when we are a part of that, then people open their hearts to us also, and they also become connected. So philanthropy would be like an organized, institutionalized focus on material welfare without any consideration of spiritual welfare. But like Prabhupada himself wanted to feed the child who was hungry and wanted annakshetra around the temple. So similarly, this is simple extension of, say, the principle of charity within the rural setting that we are in. And then you talked about women's empowerment and how this is meant to help them so that they can take better care of their families, have a supplementary source of income. And in that way, their own family issues can be taken better care of. They can be empowered in that way. Not to make things disruptive for them. And then lastly, we talked about technology. it's be optimum. Now, where there is the technology is very disruptive and destructive economically, ecologically, like with Terminator seeds, then we want to stop that. And you discussed also about how you have this whole system set up by which they can themselves have seeds, and then they can produce seeds, they can stock seeds, and that can also become like a source of income and for them and in a cluster of families. And so where other places, our purpose is not to be pro or anti-technology. It is optimum use so that outreach can happen. And whether it is here, when so many people, school children who don't come to the temple come here, so that's because they have opportunity to experience nature. And certain technology, certain level of comforts make sure that they can be here and do whatever it is. And similarly, with respect to villages, if there is some amount of development happening, we are not opposed to that. Our focus is that our focus is outreach, and whatever is required to maximize that, we do that. And in a way, what Prabhupada told, you talk about three models of Prabhupada talking about, say, farm communities. One is the devotees become self-sustained, grow whatever and live. Then second is devotees provide things to the local temples from the farm. And third is, you say Prabhupada in Hyderabad mentioned that, we can help the local farmers also. And that's what you have been doing in an amazingly successful way. And as I said, to conclude, a universe of the marriage of the rural, of agriculture, sustainable living and spiritual outreach has been done over here. Amazing. Thank you very much, Prabhu. You want to add anything or put any concluding words?
Concluding words will be like our Lord Krishna stays in village. Vrindavan is village, forest. So whether we like it or not, we cannot accept that. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also appeared in Navadvip. That's also a village. So Nityananda also appeared in Ekachakradham. That's also a village.
Okay.
So definitely the village life is very peaceful, very satisfying content. When you have food in abundance, actually that gives you real security and time for Krishna conscious activities. And that's what Shankar wanted. And whatever be possible, we'll just make few humble attempts to fulfill his desire. Hare Krishna.
Jai. Thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki jai. Thank you, Sanat Kumar Prabhu, for your time. It's been wonderful talking with you. Hare
Thank
Krishna.
Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.